In this video, I'm going to cover some of the action that takes place at the end of the vertex pipeline, which is right here. This topic was not really addressed in the previous tutorials, so better late than never. Coming up. Okay, we already know that 3D vertex positions are transformed from local space to world and view space, and then projected to 2D so that they can be rendered on the screen. We also learned about perspective division, which is a fixed function operation that actually completes the projection matrix, which is applied in the vertex shader. After perspective division, the X, Y, and Z coordinates are set to be a normalized device coordinates, or NDC, which is a normalized box that goes from minus 1 to 1 on all axes. These coordinates need to be mapped to the screen, and as you shall see, the math is pretty simple and you can probably develop it yourself, but there is a bit more going on here. So this was a quick recap on the process, now let's see how to map this down to the hardware. From a very high level view, the graphics pipeline is composed of three main stages: vertex processing, the rasterizer, and fragment processing. Vertex processing includes the mandatory vertex shader plus the optional tessellation stages and the geometry shader. Everything that we're going to talk about today happens after the last of these stages has been completed. We still haven't studied the last two, so for now, let's assume that only the vertex shader is active. At this stage in the pipeline, we find several fixed function vertex post-processing stages. They're called fixed function because they are standard hardware logic operations that can be controlled by the application to some degree, but no programming or shader stuff is involved. And the stages are as follows: transform feedback, primitive queries, flat shading, primitive clipping, shader output clipping, perspective division, viewport mapping, front face determination, and generic attribute clipping. Phew! Since I want us to focus on the position coordinates, we're going to discuss mostly clipping and viewport mapping. The result will be screen space coordinates that can now be handed over to the rasterizer for rasterization. The reason that we need clipping is very simple. If the triangle is going to end up outside of the visible screen, there is no point in wasting precious cycles on further processing. In almost any 3D game that you can think of, the screen serves as a kind of a virtual window into a 3D world which limits what we can see. At any point in the game, there is a ton of stuff that is behind the player or simply too far off to one of the sides. This means that many triangles in the current frame won't be rendered, while some of them will be partially rendered. It makes sense to handle it before the heavy lifting of rasterization and fragment processing begins. This is the job of the clipper. It determines whether the triangle is fully inside the window, in which case the result of the vertex shader can simply be forwarded as is to the next stage, fully outside the window, in which case it can be dropped entirely, or something in between. In some cases, it may even be required to subdivide the triangle into smaller pieces by generating new vertices. OpenGL requires that all X and Y coordinates will be clipped to a range between the positive and negative value of whatever you currently have in the W component of the position vector. Now, this may seem odd at first glance, until we remember that after applying perspective division, we get exactly the range of NDC space, minus 1 to 1. As you will see in a minute, this range is now ready to be mapped to the window. The thing is that the OpenGL designers kind of assumed that the position coordinate coming out of the vertex shader is something that was multiplied by the projection matrix. They knew that for projecting from 3D to 2D, we will need to divide by the Z coordinate, and they also knew that we can do that using matrix multiplication. Therefore, the perspective division step was designed under the assumption that we will copy the original Z into the W component of the output vector, hence the name perspective division. The Z itself is going to be transformed in a way which will prepare it for storage in the depth buffer. I've already covered the development of the perspective projection matrix in a couple of previous videos, so make sure to watch them for further details. I'll put a link in the video description below. I'll just remind you that in order to copy the original Z into the W component, we have the value of 1 in the third column of the fourth row of the perspective projection matrix. You can do the dot product and see for yourself. So the clipper clips the X and Y coordinates to a range of negative W to positive W, which is actually negative Z to positive Z. Now what about the Z coordinate? This is a bit more complex. The maximum value of Z is clipped to positive W, as usual, Well, the minimum is set to zmin. The value of zmin depends on the function glClipControl. This function takes two enum arguments, an origin and a depth mode. If the depth mode is set to negative 1 to 1, the value of zmin is negative w. If the depth mode is 0 to 1, zmin is set to 0. This means that after perspective division, the value of z can either be between minus 1 to 1 or 0 to 1. You may be wondering why we even need this flexibility, and the reason is that the handling of z is very delicate and can lead to the notorious problem of z fighting, where two overlapping triangles clash because their z values are very close. There are various methods to deal with this problem, which is why OpenGL allows the developer this level of control. The topic of z accuracy is very interesting, but is a bit out of scope right now, so it will have to wait to a future video. If you never call glClipControl, the default value of depth mode is negative 1 to 1. Another thing you may be wondering about is how does the z range of minus 1 to 1 works with the depth buffer whose range goes from 0 to 1? The answer to that lies in the next two stages. After the two clipping stages, we perform perspective division and then viewport mapping. As we already know, the result of perspective division is a 3D vector where every coordinate has been divided by W. W itself is now always 1, so we can simply ignore it. Let's take a look at this topic in the OpenGL specification. Note that the Y coordinate is multiplied by F, and it says that F is 1 when the clip control origin is lower left, and minus 1 when the origin is upper left. Minus 1 effectively flips the image upside down, and the reason is simply compatibility with DirectX. In DirectX, the 0,0 coordinate of the window is set to the top left corner, while in OpenGL the default is the bottom left corner. If you're developing a game for multiple platforms, or if you're porting a game from Xbox or Windows to the OpenGL world, you can use this parameter to align the system to a common baseline. After perspective division, we have viewport mapping. This step translates the NDC coordinates to window coordinates. It provides separation between the logical world of 3D transformations and the physical world of pixels on the screen. In order to map the X coordinate, we multiply it by half of the window width in pixels and add the center of the window along the X axis. For example, if the window width is 800 pixels, the center is 400. This equation will map the NDC range minus 1 to 1 to the physical range of 0 to 800. Calculating Y in screen space is exactly the same. We just need to use the height of the window instead of the width. Let's see the Z transformation, and once again we have a twist. We need to scale Z and add a bias. If you configure the depth mode to be negative 1 to 1, then the scaling factor and the bias are both a half. This maps the range minus 1 to 1 to 0 to 1. If the depth mode is 0 to 1, then the scaling factor is 1 and the bias is 0, so the range 0 to 1 remains 0 to 1. The bottom line is that regardless of how the depth mode is configured, we always end up with a Z range of 0 to 1, and this is the range of the depth buffer. The cool thing about viewport mapping is that it allows us to render to a smaller region of the actual window. The function glViewport takes the X and Y coordinates of the bottom left corner of a rectangle, and the width and height of that rectangle. OpenGL will use these values to calculate the center of the viewable rectangle and will perform viewport mapping using the equation that we just saw. This can be very useful when you want to subdivide the window for a multiplayer game or use part of the window for a head-up display. Let's use this function in a quick demo. I've taken the code from the skeletal animation tutorial, and in the render loop I've added 4 calls to glViewport. You can see that the width and height of the rectangle in all 4 calls is half of the original value, so basically we are rendering into 1/4 of the window. The X and Y coordinates are set to the bottom left corner of the 4 quadrants of the window. For each quadrant, we have a different camera with a different target vector. The first camera is located at minus 10 on the Z axis, and the target vector is the positive Z axis. The second camera is exactly the opposite. 10 on the z-axis, and the target vector is the negative z-axis. We also have a camera on the left and the camera on the right. From each camera, we extract the view matrix, recalculate the WVP matrix, and set it into the vertex shader. We can now render the object, and it will end up in the rectangle that was configured in the most recent call to glViewport. This technique is used by tools like Blender to provide multiple views of the same model. Now let's see the effect of glClipControl. I've added a call to this function with gl upper left and gl negative 1 to 1. As you can see, this causes the image to be flipped since the origin of the window is now on the top left corner, same as DirectX. If we change it to gl bottom left, which is the default value, we get back the original result. Okay guys, if you haven't seen the tutorial on perspective projection, then you can click on the following links to do that. As always, thank you so much for watching. Please hit the like button if you found this video useful, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.